because we actually stemmed from being a live playing band, and Diamond Life was as an afterthought rather than sort of the recording and then try and recreate it. And we had all the material already there and just had to go into the studio and record it.
People think of Sade as the singer. Sade's a band, and the same guys are playing with her today as played on Diamond Life 30 years ago.
I went for an audition for a band, and it was like a jazz funk band, like a seven-piece band, and Sade was one of the background singers. And I was playing sax with them and guitar. And then, you know, we just used to hang out, me and Sade, listen to music. She turned me on to so much music, we just started writing our own songs. And then we ended up deciding that she could do a little set on her own, just like a four-piece band. We opened up for the other band, but everyone who saw her was just like wow, you know. So we just went in the studio and did the songs that we'd been doing live, kind of live in the studio. And not really thinking about anything, just doing them, you know, not thinking that we'd ever be playing halls or we were just playing tiny little clubs at the time. So it all kind of got carried away. In the early 80s, we were in kind of like punk bands and you know, kind of new wave bands. And it was all about getting dressed up, and it was about, you know, cross-gender, having fun, you know, confusing people, you know. And, you know, and then also, you know, like the punk thing, you know, growing up with The Clash, first album, Total Punk, but they ended up doing all this like, kind of hip-hop dance, did reggae, did soul, bit of jazz, Jimmy Jazz, you know, it's all about mixing everything up. Well, I remember like it had done really well in Europe, the record, and it kind of made sense there, but America, the record company just weren't sure about it at all. So like, we can't get this on the radio.
Michael Jackson and Prince are working their sort of crossover magic, sort of taking black music into what was then called album-oriented radio. And hip-hop is bubbling up in a really nice way. Run DMC is hot then. You're really strongly into what we now consider the old school. So you had, you know, sort of the super masculine guys in hip-hop and, you know, the sort of guys who are doing a mixture of masculinity and femininity, you know, in Michael Jackson and Prince and some others. But I remember, you know, even as a young teenager, somehow finding Diamond Life and playing that in my room when I could have been playing Thriller, when I could have been playing, you know, Purple Rain, when I could have been playing Run DMC.
They finally released it, and my brother, my younger brother, who was in Miami at the time, he was working on cruise ships or something, and he said, "You've got to hear this." And he was listening to the radio, and he's flipping through the stations, and he played it to me over the phone. It was playing on three different like stations at the same time.
It's great that the album came in so high that we didn't actually expect that it would come in at one. We had no idea at all, so it was pretty much of a surprise.
It was a huge crossover hit. People listened to it that liked hip-hop, people that liked mainstream pop. It was a huge, with the videos, it was a huge MTV hit.
The music of Sade is still incredibly important to people, and the records are really, they age well, I think. You know, her music still, you could put it on right now and it sounds fresh and it sounds sharp and it sounds modern, and you know, people, I think if you introduced it to people who are just into music right now or 15 to 25 now, they would still experience it similarly to how we did in terms of falling in love with it and understanding this is great romantic music.
Well, thanks to the success of Diamond Life, I was able to buy some marvelous new furniture. I bought this wonderful painting, which I must show you. It's a masterpiece. And do you like it?